because Jesus Christ once for all has satisfied the justice of God and sacrificed himself and shed his blood as an atonement for us. Now, he says, it is your very life, your body, that becomes the temple and living place of the Holy Spirit. Living truth.
Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me?
And from the top.
And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's love? Died he for me, who caused this pain for me to live to death? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me?
Tis
mystery all, the immortal dies, and explore his strange design.
Even
Sarah tries to sound the depths of love divine. Tis mercy all, let earth adore, let angel minds incline no more.
Tis mercy all, let earth adore, let angel minds incline no more.
Ladies on the third.
Emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race.
Together,
tis mercy all.
Yes.
This is your final boarding call for Israel 2016. Don't miss out on this amazing experience. Reserve your place now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family on a trip of a lifetime. This is your last chance to reserve your spot now. For November 17th to the 27th, 2016. Visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. That's 1-877-465-3442.
Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time.
If you've got a Bible with you this afternoon, I'm going to read from the book of Ezekiel and chapter 40. Ezekiel is probably one of the clean parts of your Bible. Not many dirty finger marks there, because it's not a book that we read very often. Ezekiel chapter 40, verse 1 says, "In the 25th year of our exile, at the beginning of the year, on the 10th of the month, in the 14th year after the fall of the city of Jerusalem, on that very day, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he took me there," that is to Jerusalem. "In visions of God, he took me to the land of Israel and set me on a very high mountain on whose south side were some buildings that looked like a city. He took me there and I saw a man whose appearance was like bronze. He was standing in the gateway with a linen cord and a measuring rod in his hand. And the man said to me, 'Son of man, look with your eyes and hear with your ears and pay attention to everything I'm going to show you. For that is why you've been brought here. Tell the house of Israel everything you see.'" Chapter 43, verse 1. "Then the man brought me to the gate facing east, and I saw the glory of the God of Israel coming from the east. His voice was like the roar of rushing waters, and the land was radiant with his glory. The vision I saw was like the vision I had seen when he came to destroy the city, and like the visions I had seen by the Kibar River, and I fell face down. The glory of the Lord entered the temple through the gate facing east. Then the Spirit lifted me up and brought me into the inner court, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. While the man was standing beside me, I heard someone speaking to me from the temple. He said to me, 'Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place for the soles of my feet. This is where I live among the Israelites forever.'" Now that's as far as I'm going to read. This morning, we joined the two disciples on the road to Emmaus with their blind and broken hearts, which on meeting and talking and recognizing the Lord Jesus Christ became believing and burning hearts. We know from what happened subsequently, they were never the same again. We know that their emotions were transformed from being sad and bleak to being full of excitement. Their intentions were changed. Instead of going on while they had arrived in Emmaus, they turned back and went back to Jerusalem. We know their conversations were changed from doubt to delight. And whoever these two people were, we know one was called Cleopas. We don't know who the other one was. They weren't two of the 12 of Jesus' apostles, but they were amongst those who were his disciples. Though they disappear from history, we know that they would never have been the same again. And the key that opened their hearts and changed their lives and set them on fire, gave them these burning hearts, was that the Lord Jesus, beginning with Moses, Luke 24, 27 tells us, and all the prophets explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Jesus once said to a group of Pharisees, you search the scriptures because you think in them you have eternal life, but they bear witness to me, and you do not come to me that you might have life. And I want to continue what we began this morning by looking at what it was about Moses that was fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ and through his work. Now, we probably think of Moses initially as the lawgiver, which of course he was. He was the man God called up Mount Sinai and gave him the tablets of stone. As these two men had left Jerusalem to go to Emmaus, and by the way, one of them might have been a woman. There might have been a couple, in fact. We don't know who the other person was. But as they left Jerusalem, they may have looked back over their shoulder, and the dominating theme of the skyline of Jerusalem was the temple. And when they had met with Jesus, and they had understood not only him, but they suddenly understood all of the Old Testament scriptures in the light of him, they returned to Jerusalem, it tells us, and they stayed continually at the temple. The original temple in Jerusalem was built by Solomon in the 950s BC. It was destroyed 400 years later by the Babylonians. It was then rebuilt by Ezra when he led the first returning people to Jerusalem because the Babylonian Empire itself began to wane and was overrun by the Persian Empire, and the Persians were more tolerant of their occupied people, more kind to their occupied people. They didn't boss them around. They allowed some of them to go back home to Jerusalem, and Ezra built the temple, and Nehemiah followed and built the walls around the city, and you can still see some of the walls that Nehemiah built if you went down to the city of David that they've unearthed some of Nehemiah's walls. Herod, as you know, expanded the temple and built the Temple Mount to place it on level ground, and the western wall is the only remaining part of the restraining wall from around the temple of that period. But when Jesus died, 2 days before he met these men, he met them on the Sunday. He'd died on the Friday. He'd risen again on the third day, the morning of the Sunday. When Jesus died, his last word from the cross was, "It is finished." And something dramatic happened in the temple at that moment. Matthew 27, verse 50 says, "When Jesus cried out again in a loud voice," and we know from other gospels what he cried out was, "It is finished." He gave up his spirit. At that moment, Matthew 27, 51 says, the curtain in the temple was torn from top to the bottom. The curtain that separated the Holy of Holies from the rest of the temple called the Holy Place, the Holy of Holies, was accessible only once a year by the high priest, bringing blood for the atonement of the nation. And now the curtain dividing that was ripped from top to bottom. And what it was saying was this, that God is no longer accessible only in this place, the Holy of Holies. This is no longer God's home address. He's moving out. And within 40 years, the temple itself had been reduced to rubble by the Romans in 70 AD. And it has never yet been rebuilt. It is the intention, of course, of Judaism to rebuild it one day. But I would suggest to you that God isn't particularly interested in rebuilding that temple. Because though the curtain that contained that holy place, the Holy of Holies, where God's presence resided, as you've seen signs by the Western Wall saying the divine presence always rests at the Western Wall, that has been adopted simply because the Holy of Holies is no longer there, but the divine presence was in the Holy of Holies. But though that curtain was torn and the temple was destroyed, the word temple continues through the New Testament, but with a new and a very important different meaning. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16, Paul writes this, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred and you are that temple." Not now the physical building in Jerusalem, that was the prototype, that was the foreshadowing, that was the picture that illustrates what would be fulfilled through the work and person of the Lord Jesus Christ. But now, says Paul, you are the place where God lives. That's his dwelling place. That's his temple. 1 Corinthians 6:19. "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you receive from God? You're not your own. You are bought at a price." In 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 16, "For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I'll be their God, and they'll be my people." And when Paul writes that, he is quoting from Leviticus chapter 26, where God is speaking about the physical tabernacle that would be replaced by the temple eventually when they got to Israel, to Canaan. And what God said about the physical tabernacle and temple under the old covenant, Paul takes that exact quotation and says, "This is you that God is speaking about here." Because the place where God makes his home is not a physical building now where he's approached an elaborate mechanism, including priests and blood sacrifices and all kinds of rituals and ceremonial cleansing until one day, once a year only, on your behalf, a high priest walks into that Holy of Holies with blood, sprinkles the Ark of the Covenant, and comes out and declares you to be forgiven and reconciled to God. No longer is that going to be what this is all about, but because Jesus Christ once for all has satisfied the justice of God and sacrificed himself and shed his blood as an atonement for us. Now, he says, it is your very life, your body, that becomes the temple and living place of the Holy Spirit. And this, of course, is the genius and the heart of the gospel. That we ourselves, ordinary human beings, become the actual dwelling place of God. When we open our lives to him. In this vision that Ezekiel has for 9 chapters, the end of his prophecy, he gives us an incredible amount of detail about a temple that he has a vision of. We have more detail about Ezekiel's vision than we have about Solomon's temple itself. We have a lot of detail about the measurements, facts about its structure. And the reason I suggest to you that we are given this is because they are all suggestive of spiritual truths that in the light of what Jesus Christ has accomplished make sense to us. And of course, we could spend many sessions looking at all of those, and we won't be able to, but in the two sessions that I am responsible for over these 2 days, I want us to look supremely at this whole idea that first and foremost, the temple is the dwelling place of God. It's where he makes his home. And first and foremost, the issues regarding the gospel of Jesus Christ is not simply to get rid of our sin and cleanse us from a guilty conscience. That is a wonderful, liberating feeling, but that is not the purpose for which Jesus died. That is a means to an end. The end is that having forgiven us of our sin, having cleansed us of our guilt, he might come by his Holy Spirit to live within us. And as Ian Thomas used to say, the gospel is not primarily about getting people out of hell and into heaven. It's primarily about getting God out of heaven into people. That God himself might make our bodies the temple where he dwells, where he lives. Now, of course, the idea that God could be limited to a building in a particular geographical location in Jerusalem sounds a crazy idea. And when Solomon dedicated the first temple, in his dedication of it, he says, in effect, this is a crazy idea. Because in 2 Chronicles 6 and verse 18, he said, "The heavens, even the highest heavens, cannot contain you. How much less this temple I have built?" So Solomon's saying this is a crazy, incongruous thing, that we are talking about God indwelling a building here. The highest heavens can't contain him, how much less the building which I have made. And of course, that is true. But the God who is omnipresent, that is present at all places at all times, who cannot be contained in the highest heavens, chooses to concentrate his presence in certain places. When Moses built the tabernacle, and God told him to build the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle and to place the Ark of the Covenant there, he said to him, "There I will meet with you." And when it was called the Tent of Meeting, it was not because people came to meet with each other, as in going to a meeting, but they came there to meet with God. Because although God is omnipresent, he's as much outside as inside the tabernacle and the temple, he has made his presence manifest, concentrated, experiential in that particular place. And we must distinguish between these two aspects of the presence of God. There is his universal presence, his omnipresence. You know, David, Psalm 139, verse 7 says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there." And he goes on to talk about the fact that there's nowhere I can escape from God because he is everywhere. That is a truth in the scriptures. But there's also in scripture his focused presence, his personalized presence. I don't know what good words to use. Some theologians have called it his manifest presence. That is something altogether different. That involves conscious communion and intimacy with God. Not just, yes, God is here because he's everywhere, but there's a connection. It was from that presence that Adam fled in the Garden of Eden. It was that presence that was exhibited in the Holy of Holies. It is that presence which is restored to Christian experience. When Paul says, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? It's what Paul implied when in Romans 8, verse 15, he says, "For you received the spirit of sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." He is not talking about merely a point of doctrine there. He's talking about something experiential. Not does your doctrine say the Holy Spirit lives in me, but the Spirit bears witness with our spirits that we're children of God, that experientially we know God. Now, of course, there are times in our lives when we sense a distance from God. You see, it's too easy to live the Christian life outside of that. It's too easy to have a Christian life that consists primarily of theological propositions against which I check the box and say, yes, I believe that. Yes, my church teaches that. But not to know the manifest presence, the focused presence, the experiential presence of God within us. Some of you may have already discovered today in the reflection time that after 5 minutes, you don't know what to do. Because you don't actually know God. You may know Christianity, but God himself is simply the patron of your Christianity, not the actual substance and life. If I can take you back to Ezekiel's vision of this temple, which teaches us truths about the physical temple that you and I become for the Holy Spirit, it says in chapter 43 and verse 5, "Then the Spirit lifted me up and brought me into the inner court, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple." What does he mean, the glory of the Lord filled the temple? This word glory is a word that we use often without definition in the Christian life. And in Scripture, it occurs with various shades of meaning, depending on its context. But essentially, the glory of God is the presence of God exhibiting the character of God. It is the presence of God exhibiting the character of God. So when in John's Gospel, in John chapter 1 and verse 14, John writes, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." What was it that John saw? We saw his glory. What did you see, John? Was it a bright light above his head? What was it? No, they saw in Jesus the presence of God exhibiting the character of God. And so as they walked around this beautiful Lake of Galilee that is behind me and in front of you this afternoon, if a leper was on the street of Capernaum, he was obligated to ring his bell to let people know that he had this dreaded contagious disease. If anybody comes close, you might catch it. Keep away. And have you ever noticed that Jesus always touched lepers? He didn't touch everybody he healed. Sometimes he just spoke the word to them, but he touched lepers. Nobody touched lepers. We saw what God was like. We saw his character. We saw what God was like. He touched the untouchables. The way he made himself the friend of women, everybody else was embarrassed to be seen with. Traveling from Judea up to Galilee on one occasion, passing through Samaria, sitting by the well while his disciples went to buy some food, and a woman came to draw water, a woman who had been married 5 times, living with a man she was not married to anymore. a woman who was desperately thirsty, and Jesus recognized that thirst. All these other things were mere symptoms of a thirst that had never been satisfied. And he said, if you drank the water I give you, you will never thirst again. It didn't make sense to her at first, but suddenly the penny dropped. Why was she coming on her own to the well in the heat of the day? Because she was ostracized by everybody else. And Jesus became her friend. That's what God is like. The glory of God is the moral character of God. When the disciples in their enthusiasm tried to keep the kids away because they were a nuisance and they slowed Jesus down, and there were lots of people who were more important who wanted to see him, he said, no, let them come to me. And they came and climbed all over him, and he loved them and they loved him. We saw what God was like. The glory of God is the moral character of God, his presence exhibiting his character. Now, the reason why this is significant to us is because we have a fundamental problem described in Romans 3 and verse 23 in these words, for all have sinned and fall short of what? The glory of God. This glory of God, which is the presence of God expressing the character of God, is the very thing that we are missing. Sin is not only the cause of that, though it is back in the beginning. It is also the symptom of that. That detached from God, separated from the glory of God, the moral presence and character of God, we cannot live as we're designed to live. And so this picture that Ezekiel has, this vision that he has, is that the glory of God entered the temple, and the Spirit lifted me up, brought me into the inner court, that is, into the Holy of Holies, the very inner part, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the message given to Ezekiel is this, that the place that God wants to make his home, the temple under the old covenant, men, women, boys, and girls under the new covenant, is a place where he needs to enter and fill with a sense of his presence and his glory. The vision of this temple Ezekiel has is that God has made this place his home. This is what had happened in the temple Solomon had built when he built it. And they dedicated the temple in 2 Chronicles chapter 5. It says that the temple of the Lord was filled with a cloud, and the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God. When they dedicated this thing, this temple, Solomon prayed a marvelous prayer, and suddenly the glory of God filled this temple, and the priests were overwhelmed. They were stunned. They could not do their work because God was here. We have several statements about that in the first temple. When they built the second temple, one of the prophets who encouraged the building of the second temple was Haggai. And Haggai chapter 2 and verse 9 says that he says, there, the glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Lord Almighty. What you're going to see in this temple is going to be even greater than what you saw in Solomon's temple. And this is God's intention for us, that having sinned and come short of the glory of God is going to be restored into our experience. How does that take place? Well, Colossians chapter 1, verse 27 tells us, to them, that is the Gentiles, God has chosen to make known the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of what? Glory. That doesn't mean heaven, by the way. Sometimes people talk about dying and going to heaven. That's not a biblical use of the word. Glory is what we've sinned and come short of. Glory is what John said of Jesus. The Word became flesh, lived among us, we saw his glory. Now he says, here's what was a mystery through the Old Testament era, that Christ in you, living his life in your body by his Holy Spirit, is your hope of being restored to what you've come short of, your hope of glory. Your hope of the presence of God being restored into your life, and as a result, the character of God being exhibited in our lives. And Paul prays about this in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 16. He says, I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. I love the Amplified version of this, the Amplified Bible. It says, may he grant you out of the rich treasury of his glory to be strengthened and reinforced with mighty power in the inner man by the Holy Spirit himself indwelling your innermost being and personality. May Christ, through your faith, actually dwell and settle down, abide, and make his permanent home in your hearts. The Amplified Bible, by the way, is not the exaggerated Bible. It simply uses various words to describe what the intent was in the original language. This is more than asking Jesus to come into my heart, to be a ticket to heaven when I die. This is to enjoy a rich relationship that is built on the fact that he is present and I can know him. And Paul sets this up as a test of a genuine Christian. In 2 Corinthians 13 and verse 5, again, the Amplified Bible, it says, examine and test and evaluate yourselves to see whether you're holding to your faith and showing the proper fruits of it. Test and prove yourselves, not Christ. Do not yourselves realize and know thoroughly by an ever-increasing experience that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you're counterfeit, disapproved on trial and rejected. Now he says, do you know by an ever-increasing experience that Jesus Christ is in you, that he's alive and that you can fellowship with him and enjoy him as your friend? I think it's interesting that the moment at which those two men on the road to Emmaus recognized Jesus was not when he explained the Bible to them. He did that on the journey. The moment they recognized him is when they ate together. What is eating symbolic of? It's symbolic of fellowship and friendship. You remember that verse in Revelation 3, verse 20? I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and do what? Have supper with you. You mean Jesus comes into my life just to have supper? No, because that means I'll come in, I'll sit down, and we'll break bread together, and we'll fellowship together. I get emails from people who say to me, can I have a cup of coffee with you sometime? Or they say, can I meet you for lunch? They're not interested in the lunch. That's not what they're asking for. I feel like replying and say, go and get your own lunch. Go and make your own coffee. They're not talking about the lunch or the coffee. They're saying, can we chat? Can we meet? Can we talk? What if you don't talk to Jesus? It's a very good chance you'll miss him. Had Jesus continued walking when they got to Emmaus, and they persuaded him not to, of course, and to stay and spend the night with them, but had he continued walking, they may have gone into their house and said, wow, that was a fascinating Bible study. Well, I've never seen the Old Testament that way before. That's amazing. Look at how it all points. This means that, and this means that. Amazing. I think I'll go back and teach Bible class about this. That wouldn't have changed their life. It's in the light of their understanding. It's necessary to understand the scriptures. But it's in fellowship with God, in communion with him, that this becomes experiential. Now let me quickly show you two things as to why this was true, that the glory of God filled the temple, and the grounds on which the glory of God will fill your life and mine. In verse 6 and 7, while the man was standing beside him, This is chapter 43, verse 6 and 7. While the man was standing beside him, I heard someone speaking to me from inside the temple. He said, Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place of the soles of my feet. This is where I will live among the Israelites forever. Two significant statements there. Having just observed the glory of God filled the place, it's as though God says, do you want to know why this is so, Ezekiel? Here's the first reason. This is the place of my throne. Now, the meaning there is obvious. A throne is about a king. The reason why my glory fills this place, God is saying, is because I'm not here as a guest. I am here to occupy a throne. You see, the temple of God and the throne of God go together. When we think of the kingdom of God, let's not think of something out there or something in the future or something back there. Jesus said in Luke 17 and verse 20, the kingdom of God does not come with your careful observation, nor will people say, here it is, or there it is, because the kingdom of God is within you. Now, again, as with much of Scripture, there are different facets to what Scripture refers to when it speaks of the kingdom of God. But Jesus is saying to people, don't make the mistake of looking out there or up there or back there. Don't listen to somebody who says, it's over here or it's coming next year. The kingdom is the place where the king rules. Where is that? The kingdom of God is within you. And of course, that speaks of a number of things. It includes his authority, recognizing his authority in our lives. It also includes his leading in our lives, his providing for us, his protection of us. Those are all things that a king under the Old Testament era in Judah and Israel were designed to do. To rule, to lead, to provide, and to protect. This would have been all the issues in Ezekiel's understanding of what it means when this is the place of my throne. Not a tyrant like the king of Babylon, but one who leads and guides and provides and protects. And sometimes we stumble in our Christian lives because we get to this point and we will not have this man reign over us. We'll have this man get us out of our guilt. We'll have this man get us into heaven when we die. But we will not have this man reign over us, which we find said of people in the New Testament days when they met with Jesus. They said, we'll not have this man reign over us. Now, sometimes we feel intimidated by this, but let's not be intimidated. Let's understand that the reign of the Lord Jesus Christ in our lives is actually liberating and freeing. So, Ezekiel, you want to know why the glory of God fills the place? It's because this is the place of my throne. Can I ask you that question regarding your own life? Is Jesus Christ on the throne? Is he familiar enough to you to trust him with the throne of your life? And to submit to him, but at the same time, to enjoy his provision, his protection, his leading, as well as his authority. Second thing he said, in verse 7 of Ezekiel 43, Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place for the soles of my feet. That's an interesting phrase, but it's a recurring one in the Old Testament. Moses said to the Israelites in Deuteronomy chapter 11, every place where the soles of your feet shall tread will be yours. When Joshua was commissioned by God after Moses died, in Joshua 1 verse 3, God said, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread, I have given you, as I promised Moses. When they crossed the Jordan River in Joshua chapter 3, verse 13 says, as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bore the ark of the Lord of all the earth, rests in the waters of Jordan, the waters of the Jordan shall be cut off. And you remember how God opened the Jordan River. You place the soles of your feet in that water, and it'll be cut off. When Solomon became king, he says in 1 Kings 5, verse 3, you know how that David, my father, could not build a house in the name of the Lord his God for the wars which were about him on every side until the Lord put them under the soles of his feet. What's the image being given here? Under the soles of the feet. Malachi 4 and verse 3, you'll tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet. In the day I shall do this, says the Lord. The picture is, in every case, something under the soles of their feet is a picture of captured, subjected, and occupied territory. In every case, it involved battle, it involved warfare, but it involved the taking of territory. And God says, this is the place of my throne. That's where I am in authority. But it's also the place where I have brought enemies under control, the place of the soles of my feet. We battle, of course, and we'll battle all our days with the world, the flesh, and the devil. The three enemies are identified for us in the book of James. James speaks about those three. But the purpose of the Lord Jesus is to place under the soles of his feet those enemies that rise up and attack us and would seek to thwart our walk with God. We're not passive in that process. I think a mistake I have made in my life for some time was to assume it was simply saying, well, Lord, you do it, and I'm passive. Then you find yourself being overtaken by things, and you think, well, why in the world, Lord, I'm trusting you? Because I've since recognized in Scripture that there is a intentional, disciplined fighting against those things which would attack us and undermine us and seek to destroy us. You know, in recent times, I've been struck by Paul's statement in 1 Corinthians 9, verse 27, where he writes there, I beat my body and make it my slave, so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. Now, if you met the Apostle Paul, or I met the Apostle, and said, and he said, you know, I'm really worried that I might be disqualified after all my apostleship and all my ministry, that I might end up being disqualified. I'm really worried about that. Would you give me some advice? What would you say to the Apostle Paul? Would you say, as I probably would have said, well, Paul, you just keep trusting. You just pray harder. Spend more time in the Word. What was Paul's solution? I beat my body. One translation says, I keep a watch over my body. Another one says, I buffet my body. I heard somebody read that once and they misread it and said, I buffet my body. Well, don't do that. We do that enough. But Paul says, to stop me being disqualified, it's not enough to say spiritually I am in communion with God. I've got to discipline my body. And I realize this is all over the New Testament in all kinds of ways. Jesus said, you've heard it said, do not commit adultery. I say to you, if you look at a woman and lust after her, you're already guilty in your mind and your heart. And then he said this, if your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away. If your right hand causes you to sin, cut off and throw it away. Well, you think, well, why does he suddenly change the subject? He talks about adultery and lust. And then he says, you know, if your right hand's a problem, cut it off. Your eyes a problem, gouge it out. Later he says, if your foot leads you into trouble, cut it off. Well, stop and think about that for a moment. He's talked about adultery and about lust. And the primary agents in sexual arousal are sight and touch. And he says, if you've got a problem with lust, do something about your eye. Do something about your hand. Do something about your foot. Don't go where you're going to walk into trouble. Gouge out your eye. We recognize not literally, of course. He never taught that we violate the body in that way, but metaphorically saying, don't simply pray about it when you're struggling in some of these areas, actually do something. Paul says, I beat my body. I bring it under control. And so when God says to Ezekiel, the reason why the glory of God fills this place, it's the place of my throne. It's also the place of the soles of my feet, where the enemies have been put under my feet. And that is not just a spiritual issue, it is also a physical issue that we have to come to terms with. When Jesus rose from the dead, he put everything under his feet, the scripture says, which means that the possibility of living victoriously is available to us. But the picture so far is that this is the dwelling place of God, a picture of your body, my body, the dwelling place of God, where there is fellowship together with God, where the glory of God fills the place, because this is a place of my throne. This is a place of the soles of my feet. This is where I am the one in charge, my throne, and the place where we're subjugating the enemies. And you know, this is what began to make sense to those men on the road to Emmaus. They won't have understood all of this in a blinding moment, but they understood on the road to Emmaus a key, which meant every time they read the Old Testament scriptures after this, they could interpret it in the light of the work of Jesus Christ and the person and presence of Jesus Christ. And they went back to the temple in Jerusalem, and they waited there until 50 days later, still in the temple courts with 120 other people, the day of Pentecost took place, and the Holy Spirit came and indwelt them, and their hearts became the dwelling place of Jesus Christ. And in the following years, they turned the world upside down.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation.
Tune in next week for part 4 of this series on the Holy Land, right here on Living Truth.
Majesty, worship His majesty, unto Jesus glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority flows from His throne unto His own. His anthem raise.
So exalt,
so exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Jesus the King, Majesty, worship His majesty, Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Anthem raised together.
So exalted.
worship His majesty. Jesus, who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus, who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Last time, sing it out.
Jesus, who died.